Let me tell you of the days of high adventure.
I'm John.
And I'm Kevin.
And this is 6 Degrees of Schwarzenegger, the podcast where we take a long, hard look at some of our favorite action movies from the era of...
Schwarzenegger is the icon of the genre, and we're taking a deep dive into some of these 80s and 90s cult action movies and breaking them all the way down.
Welcome to hell.
John, I am so drunk.
What?
Oh, my God.
She's so drunk.
She's so drunk.
In the garden, there is a girl.
Dude, beer
Hello,
is...
Hello, Mary?
Whiskey and beer are two cool things.
Thank God to the ancient Egyptians. I suppose we owe a debt of gratitude. And then all the four... everyone that came after that. Everyone that had the, oh wow.
What's happening?
What you just missed off camera, people, was Kevin's beer foaming up. That was amazing. Oh, wow. We might need to hit pause for just
my
a
pants
second.
Are wet.
Mine are too. Here's to all the people over the centuries that took a few weeks to just say, No, just let it sit out. We'll drink it later. And lived to tell the tale. You know what I'm saying?
Fuck.
Same thing with cheese. It's like, no, don't touch it. We'll eat it later.
Eat that mold.
Yeah. But we're not here to talk about booze or cheese per se, even though Kevin is covered
I am wet,
in some beer.
I'm a professional. And I'm going to power through.
You guys, this is live. This is live television right now. This is radio, not television.
Cheers to you.
Put away the gun.
John,
cheers, brother.
What are you drinking?
I am drinking Bohemian Riot by Arches Brewing, which we reckon is down in Hapeville, close by the airport. And this is their Pilsner, which I discovered at the Toco Giant. And it's excellent.
It is. I am drinking Six Bridges Brewery, Shelby Golden Ale. They're up at like John's Creek.
Alpharetta. We call it Alpharetta.
This shit's delicious, though.
Yeah. Maybe I'll have one of those before I drive a car. Just kidding. I'm just kidding. So we're here to talk about our last episode in our series on 1985's The Last Dragon. Kevin,
Barry
how do you
Barry Gordy's The Last Dragon.
That's right. Barry Gordy's. That's sort of awesome. It'd be like... Like if
Phil Spector is the
yeah
no,
exactly
okay, no,
yeah,
no, no,
not
no,
him.
No,
not
no,
him.
No.
Not him. Anyone but him. Or like if I don't know if like it probably be more commonplace nowadays for someone to be like Lady Gaga presents this motion picture because
sure.
She's in movies and stuff like that. But like for a major producer,
a mogul.
Yeah, it's an interesting phenomenon to think about the will of a music producer to be like, I'm going to make a movie and we're going to use it as a vehicle to plug all of these music videos and shitty ass songs,
yes.
Which we reckon
there
only,
was more
only,
shitty songs than good songs on
only
this.
Only one song had like major commercial appeal.
Yes. It was the DeBarge.
Yes. that song is good objectively. Or maybe a little subjectively, but anyway, The Last Dragon. So I guess I'll get us caught up on like what's happened in the movie up to this point.
Good luck with that.
And all that is that Bruce Leroy is on a spirit journey to be a master of Kung Fu. His rival is a local, self-proclaimed Shogun of Harlem who has beef with Bruce Leroy for reasons unknown. Bruce Leroy has caught the eye of local talent, music producer, TV show host, Laura Charles. Laura Charles has been abducted on numerous occasions by a local pinball magnate so that he can make his girlfriend a famous music video star. It turns out that that guy's actually a little bit crazy. So that guy has captured Bruce Leroy's brother and girlfriend,
okay,
and has made a deal with the local enemy, karate enemy, kung fu enemy. Basically, the bad guys are all in cahoots, and they are trying to lure Bruce Leroy into a trap. And when we last met, Bruce Leroy's students were going to, like, drum up some trouble to go try to help Bruce Leroy, and that's where we're at.
The stakes have never been higher.
I can't think of a time. Nothing else matters. So yeah. We pick right back up at Seventh Heaven Studios.
Yeah. Bruce Leroy Green.
Right.
Is sneaking onto the set here. Suddenly, Eddie's enormous fucking face pops up on the video screens, and he screams out, "Leroy!"
He's like laughing maniacally.
Where is this fucking camera?
It's right there in Eddie's control booth face. Maybe Rock is
unseen.
Rock is the camera guy.
Yeah, someone's like zooming in and out on Eddie's face.
Yeah, there's camera work, quote unquote, being done.
He says, "Welcome to my little party in your honor, Leroy. The guest list has been compiled so that you go out in style."
What?
I don't know. Fuck.
Yeah,
you know.
He sees that he's been like
surrounded,
like very dramatically lit bad guys in a circle around him.
Where did all these fucks come from?
He would have had to have
walked right past these guys, though, Leroy.
Yeah, it doesn't make sense. There's a lot of choreography that we haven't seen.
They come at Leroy one at a time.
Well, they're sort of like staggered entrances, because it does seem like that they're like that. Someone said they can't attack him one at a time, but it may as well be.
Yeah, Leroy takes these guys out with ease. All of a sudden, Eddie is like cheering for Leroy.
Go,
now.
Leroy!
Shit makes no sense.
He is off his nut.
Rock pulls his pistol out. He's ready just to kill Leroy. But
I can
Eddie
go to my room
him.
Right now. I can get my gun. We can
it
end
was
this.
No. We gotta let this shit play out.
I paid a lot of money to watch this.
Yeah, he's like, I set this. You know how much time and effort it took for me to set this shit up? But Eddie takes Rock's pistol from him, then starts putting on Rock's shoulder holster and everything like that.
Right.
More goons appear to fight Leroy, who produces a pair of nunchucks.
Yep.
And proceeds to just fucking kick ass.
Yeah. Badass.
Nunchucks are in the right hands are like an amazing weapon, like to see someone swing them around.
Right. It's also a strange weapon, because it's like, how did that thing come to be?
Who came to with the idea of nunchucks?
I remember originally, like when the Ninja Turtles came out, and this is before the days of internet.
Oh, teach me.
Everyone was like, what are nunchucks? And then you had kids coming to school being like, well, it's a farming implement for like threshing grain. And I was like,
Is that true?
I don't know. That's what I was told. It's like,
fine, now we got to go Google
shit. We'll Google it later. On a later episode, we'll confirm.
Back to more pressing matters. Who's your favorite Ninja Turtle?
Leonardo. You're
a Leonardo guy?
I'm a very A-type, honor-driven, like, when it comes to the a multiplayer team situation, yeah. I'm like, that's the guy, because he's like, I need all of you to fucking shut up your bullshit, because we got to get this done.
Well, two swords are also the pinnacle weapon.
Well, the most deadly weapons in the group.
Wait, so this is, all right, who's my favorite Ninja Turtle?
I'm going to say Raphael.
Yeah.
Yeah. Because he's a wisecrack.
And he's like the sort of like anti-hero-ish one.
Okay, here we go. The origin of the nunchaku is unclear. A traditional explanation holds that it was originally used by Okinawan farmers as a flail for threshing rice.
How? With a stick, not a blade?
Yeah, just like slinging it. Just whoosh. Because I think that thing would do good in a rice paddy. Yeah.
It's amazing. It's an amazing fucking weapon.
But that's what I'm saying is like, again, like beer, like wine, the nunchaku accident. Was born. It's like, holy shit, this is great. Anyway.
Oh my God. So this massive dude steps up, this behemoth who Eddie calls Goliath.
Right. just giving people
I
names.
I love that the bit players had names.
Absolutely.
This dude, Goliath, he scoops up and slams Leroy down. Then he grabs his nunchucks and, like, literally takes a bite out of them.
Yeah, it's like a horrified look on Leroy's face.
It was weird. He slams Leroy again.
Yeah, and Leroy comes right back, and the guy's like, nope, same result.
Yep. Another dude pulls up, and they just start stomping Leroy out.
Dude's like hitting him with a chain.
Yeah, that would fuck you up. Then we hear a scream, and Johnny Yu and the rest of, like, Leroy's students come running in.
The whole dojo.
How did they assemble the whole class that quickly?
Everyone lives on the same block.
I guess they're just knocking on doors, like, put your tong suit on, it's time to fight.
Yeah, I think that, yeah, they're just running down, like, running in Harlem, shouting out, like, ah!
So it's like the remix of the song Inside You starts, like, swelling.
Huh?
I feel like the odds are kind of even now, and the good guys are taking control. Johnny is doing his whole, like, fighting without knowing how to fight technique until he accidentally hits a guy
right.
and knocks him out.
And this is one of the brilliant moments in this movie where all of a sudden it's like Johnny's like, oh shit, maybe I actually do know martial arts.
Well, it's like, what's the difference between pretending like you have moves and actually having moves, except that you really just hit the guy?
Right.
Instead of pretending to throw a punch, you just punch him.
Yeah, and Johnny makes use of that.
Yeah, dude, he starts kicking ass. His skills are off the hook.
He's actually a very, very talented martial
artist.
This dude
should have been a star. I feel like his skills surpassed Timox.
I agree, yeah.
But so then young Ty, who we mentioned earlier, that's Ernie Reyes Jr. Yeah, Ty and Leroy, they're cheering on Johnny, who's like fucking pumping his chest. He's like thumping his chest.
Yeah, he's like, oh, shit, I'm a kung fu master.
I'm the fucking man. Yeah. Eddie is, like, worried, I guess, to see that his guys are starting to lose. Suddenly, one of Sho Nuff's goons, Crunch, is
what?
There.
Why the fuck is he here?
I feel like he missed his cue or some shit. He was in the wrong place. He showed up at the wrong place at the wrong time.
Why is he here, but none of Sho Nuff's other goons are there?
So I feel like Johnny needed maybe revenge for having been roughed up in the dojo earlier.
Yeah, that makes sense, but...
But it does make no sense.
There's one guy?
That Crunch is there. Yeah, I don't know.
Maybe that was Sho Nuff's thing. It's like, yeah, I'll help you, but you only get one of my guys.
But this guy, Crunch, he's there. He hits Johnny in the back. Johnny seems to be hurt. He's like right. rolling around on the ground. Ty steps up to Crunch with this, like, he's mean mugging, he's busting out moves.
There's this pan, and I love the camera, like, it follows Ernie Ray's diminutive as he is, like, this short distance of him, like, standing up and, like, making that Bruce Lee type face and, like, about to, like, get down on you, dude.
Yeah, Ernie Reyes Jr. is a star. Like, yeah. He should have been a leading man.
Yeah.
Like, he has got so much charisma on screen in every movie I've ever seen him in.
Yep.
But Crunch can't believe that this little dude, Ty, wants to fight him. So then Ty runs at him, and, like, they lock up, and he hits him with a scorpion kick.
Yeah, like, thing. Kicks. Yeah. To describe that, it's like if you flung yourself forward and your leg whipped up behind you and then kicked someone in the head, and then you fell back down to your feet.
I feel like Trinity used that move Matrix movies. But fucking shit was badass. It was awesome choreography.
Yeah.
Of all this shit. I had seen Ernie Reyes Sr., Junior's dad, choreographed all the fighting shit with the students or whatever, the kids.
Awesome.
And the director, Michael Schultz, had said that they had like on the schedule a week they were going to be shooting all these fighting things, and then they had fallen behind schedule or something. But they ended up shooting everything in like 2 days only, which is pretty impressive that they got so much shit.
The fact that we've said similar stories like that for most of the movies that we do is absolutely bananas. But this is another case in point where it's like where you watch the scene and it's like you can tell people are being a little bit trepidatious in the scene, like careful with the choreography and stuff. But like for them to have knocked all that out and for like 11-year-old or 10-year-old Ernie Reyes Jr. to be out mm-hmm. there like throwing down like that is awesome.
I love the shit. then Ty and Johnny do this like choreographed, synchronized series of moves to finish off Crunch.
They're in the same karate school.
Then they do like this kind of patty cake handshake. B-boy stance.
Yeah, I love
celebration
that.
Or whatever. It's bizarre and it makes no sense, but it's also fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Now, Leroy and his squad, yeah, they're beating the hell out of all the goons. Ty takes out these three guys by himself, which was awesome.
Yeah.
The dude who was like in camo, I think, and he was picking Ty up and swinging him around, that was Ernie Reyes Sr.
Okay, that's awesome.
Dad, yeah. So Johnny finds another set of nunchucks.
Of course.
Somewhere. He starts whipping all types of ass. His moves were better than Timox.
Don't you love? I love those. I do love in Bruce Lee movies and other stuff, or even in the Ninja Turtles movies, like the scene where the foot and the turtles are about to get down in April O'Neil's apartment, like in the business that her uncle or her, that
are, the pawn shop or whatever it was. The antique shop or something.
Yeah, the antique shop. And like there's the nunchuck off between the dude and the foot player.
A fellow chucker.
A fat chucker, eh? Yeah, I love and like watching all the old video of Bruce Lee doing this shit. It's like, it's fucking awesome.
It's awesome. That seems like the most also, maybe swords are more dangerous to do displays with.
Yeah.
Because you could slice yourself.
Right.
But nunchucks seem pretty fucking dangerous.
Yeah.
Anyway. So Ty took out a couple more dudes with this amazing, like, flying double kick.
That thing was awesome.
That kid fucking had skills, dude.
Yep.
Eddie sees, I guess, that his guys are losing. He tells Rock that we're switching it up to plan B. They grab Laura. They leave Richie behind. Richie starts like popping and locking his way out of
That's again brilliant. It's like
he's breakdancing his way
out of his binds.
Amazing. The good guys continue like to be winning every fight. Basically, Eddie gets Leroy's attention. He's like, "Hey, follow me."
Oh, okay.
That's fucking clearly a trap. But no, Leroy, we've established
fine. This is
he's
fine.
Not bright. He's not a bright guy.
Right
now. This fucking huge albino Mr. T, like white Mr. T, shows up and he grabs Leroy in this bear hug.
Right.
What the fuck?
He looks like old white Mr. T meets Buzzsaw meets Dynamo from Running Man.
Yeah, it was like a weird 80s
mashup.
Just insanity. But before
any of those other things had become popular.
And no, they definitely said, like, what if Mr. T was white? Because he had all the jewelry around his neck and everything like that.
But old, too.
Was he old? Or was he just
sort of
like
older. I think he was older and, like, that was gray hair.
So, oh, my God. So, Leroy whacks this dude in the face. Several Leroy students, they subdue the guy.
Right.
Leroy runs out of there. Following in the direction that Eddie and The Rock had taken.
Don't go into the marsh.
They had taken Laura. The students, I felt kind of weird about this.
This
pull Mr. T's, white Mr. T's pants down.
That's the same shit that happened to Dynamo in Running Man.
They pull his pants down?
Remember when his pants were down? Like, we were wondering.
Was he the Running Man series?
Yeah, we were like, why are his pants down? Like, he was going to rape.
Yeah. But he's getting rapey.
But that's what I'm saying. Like, but the pants down thing is a theme that's carried through with, and it's like, what?
To further humiliate him?
It's just
albino Mr. T or whatever his name would be.
Yeah.
But yeah, I felt weird. Like they just sort of ganged up on him and started kicking the shit out of him.
Well, he was a bad guy, so he deserved it.
I guess
it.
He was.
He would have killed the children.
They show Richie again at this point, who his hands were free and he could just easily free himself from his binds, but he continues popping and locking.
Yeah, I like that. Keep going, baby.
I'm into it.
The beat is on fire.
Ty defeated another full-grown ass man, and he was like just popping a little like breakdance move at the end and like stomped on the dude's balls or whatever.
Kicks him one last time and then
he just ruined this guy. but that was the same dude. That was Ernie Reyes Sr. again that
Being
he was beaten up,
demoralized by a 10-year-old.
By his own boy.
By my own child.
I've abandoned my child.
I've abandoned my child.
I've abandoned my boy. Shout out Daniel Day-Lewis. We know you're listening.
We know you're listening, Daniel Day-Lewis. Daniel Day-Lewis, we know that you are a regular listener to the podcast. Do not cut any of this. This is amazing. Holy shit.
Oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah. Daniel Day, we know that you're a big fan of The Last Dragon. It's one of the big reasons he kept acting.
That's why he got into acting.
Oh my God. Daniel Day-Lewis, little known fact, Daniel Day-Lewis played the role of Ty in this movie. It was so method.
He appeared as a young Asian boy.
Named Ernie Reyes Jr. Oh my God. That's good shit.
So
that's the good stuff.
Richie frees himself from his binds. He leaves the control center. I guess we got to figure he's like determined that he's going to rescue Laura.
Yeah. Or help Leroy or something.
Outside in the alleyway, we see the silhouette of Eddie, Rock, and Laura in the window of like a building across the street or some shit.
Right.
It was actually a cool Texas switch because it was one long shot where we saw the little silhouettes in the window. Mm-hmm. And then we saw
Leroy like
being
shot.
Like clueless, where'd they go? And then we see Eddie and Vanity and fucking Rock in the window like, hey, Leroy, come and follow us or whatever.
It's like
the
a different floor,
but
too.
But it was
right?
one it's single like a... shot, yeah, which there was no way that was the actual actor's silhouettes in the window. Right, it must have been some lookalikes or stand-ins or whatever. It's cool shit.
Because that was like, they would have had to have a super
It was a nice
fast
elaborate
elevator.
Shot, though. I'm sure the director was proud of that
Mr.
shot.
Mr. Schultz, good job.
So, Eddie calls out from the window that he should come on in. The like, what he says, you put on quite a show back there, but the featured act is yet to come. And taunts him to like to come inside the warehouse.
Eddie's obsessed with showbiz jargon. It's like he can't not say anything in the context of like a show.
Fucking weird shit to say.
It's like, was he like home memorizing lines all day? It's like,
yeah, he's
I've been thinking
on
about
show.
What I'm going to say all day.
I would say the word to the wise, like when the evil villain is taunting you to follow him, like it's a trap.
Yeah, just call the police and let the police go in there.
But so. Inside, Eddie takes Laura in one direction. He tells Rock, who he called Mojo.
I watched Amazon Video.
Okay.
And they say he's called him Bozo. Like, go that way, Bozo.
Okay. My subtitles or whatever said Mojo.
Yeah, he says he calls him Bozo. Like, okay. He's calling him a name.
That makes more sense.
Yeah.
So, Leroy cautiously, he enters. He's looking around the warehouse. What is this space? It's just like a huge empty space. I guess that's, Harlem real estate was maybe not as
that's all it is
as premium as like something in downtown Manhattan or whatever. I guess so. Then we see Richie sneaks into the warehouse or whatever this space is. We see Leroy throws a dart, one of those little ninja darts. He nearly hits Eddie, and he tells Eddie, you know, next time I will not miss. Eddie yanks.
Yeah, he like rattles off a couple
out.
Of shots.
Bam, bam, bam. Tells, I won't miss either next time, whatever the fuck. The Rock, I say The Rock. Rock.
Dwayne Johnson's in this movie.
Singular Rock grabs Richie. Richie stomps on Rock's foot, kicks him in the dick and balls like a bunch of times.
Yeah, and two or three times.
You'll never use that again.
Again, Richie obsessed with sex organs and their usage. You'll never use that again. He's always about using. This has a specific use case. The dick is a use thing.
I feel like he mangled Rock shit.
Really? Maybe. I don't know.
He mushed it. He mashed it. Richie runs off, but he runs right into Beast, one of Sho Nuff's goons. This is very dimly lit, but I feel like he tries to kick Beast in the balls, and you hear like a clank.
I rewound this several times, and he clearly goes to kick him.
That's his move, is the dick kick.
But Beast has like...
a metal cup or something?
Yeah, an ironclad ball cover.
And then he makes these weird grunts. He's like, or something. Like, Beast is fucking off his ass. But so Beast grabs...
Everyone's high as shit in this scene, by the way.
They're all coked up?
Yes, of course.
So Beast grabs Richie. He calls... who's like screaming, help me, Leroy.
Help
me, whatever. Leroy runs to the rescue, tells Beast he's better let Richie go. Beast hoists Richie like up above his head and just chucks him
into a pile of detritus. And there's some like there's like a big like an empty helium canister or
whatever.
Something.
It's like a scuba diving tank. Yeah,
he hits his head on like some sort of empty metal canister and it like knocks him out.
So Leroy and Beast fight now. Leroy wins pretty easily, I feel like.
Yeah, there's some back and forth, but it's not
Beast
a contest.
Beast maybe is one good kick in, but yeah, Leroy pretty much dominates the fight. Leroy goes to check on Richie, who's waking up. He's like, I'm going to save you, Laura, or some type shit.
Richie
when he wakes
is
up.
Clearly concussed.
Oh, yeah, dude's like incoherent. So then Leroy takes Richie and he locks him in this sort of like caged off.
It's for your own good.
Area. It was weird that there were lockers and stuff back there, like it was a locker room. I don't know what this space ever was.
Yeah, I don't either, except for that it, yeah, like some industrial space and there were locker rooms and the people were like, maybe there was an assembly line, but there's no assembly
like
material
changing
in there.
Into your work wear? I don't know.
Yeah,
what.
To your coveralls.
But so Leroy resumes his search. And Sho Nuff now steps out. He's like rocking this red gi.
It's like emblazoned with a tiger on one shoulder and there's stripes down the side.
I love it, man.
Man, everything he wears in this movie, but I like that it's sort of like in Karate Kid 2 where Sato and Miyagi were supposed to both be getting down and they're both like wearing their traditional garb. And that's what this scene reminded me of, and probably Karate Kid 2 stole from this movie.
Absolutely. Man, why not?
Probably not, but still.
I don't know. But he asked Leroy, are you warmed up yet? Leroy looked like terrified of Sho at the moment.
Yeah.
Eddie is watching with this like enthusiasm. He's telling Laura, there's nothing like this on stage, screen, radio, TV, or cable, baby. This is an exclusive.
He's got fucking the heart on.
He is coked out of his mind.
If he thought ahead, he would have been videoing all this. He would have been recording it.
Yeah, the actor, Murney, had like, I feel like it cranked his like shit up to 11.
Oh, big time. Because he's like, at this point, he's a kidnapper. Like, all the action is happening elsewhere. So he's got to be interesting when he can be. So they're like, yeah, man, just be drugged up the whole time.
So Leroy and Sho Nuff are circling each other in this like sort of the tension is building, whatever. Leroy throws a series of kicks, but Sho Nuff is dodging all of them.
Right.
That moment, I'm like, oh, shit, this Sho Nuff, he's like for real.
Yeah.
Like he's got the skills. So Sho Nuff, he's blocking Leroy's punches, scoffing at him, begins hitting Leroy with a series of punches himself. Leroy battles back, but Sho Nuff gets a serious and
he's
like
okay. It's like, all right, fine.
Yeah, he kicked Leroy right through this wall. It was like sort of that like corrugated sheet metal type shit, whatever. So Sho Nuff pursues Leroy through into like the other area of the building or whatever it is. He's stalking Leroy, but then Leroy comes like flying out of nowhere.
Yeah, and he like blindsides him.
He lays him out. Sho Nuff looked like fucked up.
Yeah, like that hit was hard.
When they showed him like laid out or whatever. Leroy takes a moment to sort of relax. He starts to walk away. But then we hear Sho Nuff call out, Leroy! And Leroy turns back, sees Sho Nuff is like nowhere to be seen. It's like some Michael Myers type like horror movie shit, whatever. Leroy looks scared. And we start to hear the song, The Last Dragon, cueing in by David Dwight.
Dwight
is playing, yeah. Leroy is searching high and low for Sho Nuff. Sho Nuff calls out to him, and we turn and see Sho Nuff. His hands are like glowing red.
Oh,
it's like
I
some
love it.
Fucking Sith shit.
I
Isn't
remember
it like Star Wars.
Yeah, it's exactly
type?
What it's supposed to be, and I remember this so clearly from being a kid.
And he's like, "Playtime's over, boy." And
love that effect. So
I thought that
cool.
was the first indication that the glow is like an actual real thing.
Right. Yeah.
And it's actually like the visual effects were fucking killer.
But it's like, what does that say about like Sho Nuff's commitment to self and martial arts? And like, maybe his path is different. Maybe it is like you say, it's like a Sith thing, but it's like,
he's got the glow though.
He's also got the glow. He's achieved the glow and say what you want to.
Dude.
He's also achieved it.
What probably should have happened in the movie is they should have established that the glow was like a real actual thing earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Like there could have been flashes of it earlier in the movie, you
sure.
know, as opposed to just like breaking it out in the third act. But whatever.
It's still cool. And like we say, the effect is awesome.
So Eddie and Laura have come out of hiding to watch.
Eddie wants to watch
the showdown, whatever it is. Leroy is like terrified, I guess, by Sho Nuff's glow. Sho Nuff starts just beating the hell out of Leroy.
Yeah.
There's like these red glow flashes like sparks, every time he hits him with something. It's like, yeah, it's full on Star Wars shit. But Leroy is doubled over. Sho Nuff is sort of grabbing him. He's like, now when I say who's the master, you say Sho Nuff. Leroy refuses.
Nah.
Sho Nuff continues to like whip his ass all around the warehouse.
And then we see like back at the cage, like Richie gets free.
Yeah, he busts out.
Sho Nuff does this weird like roll throw and flings Leroy like across the floor and then does this amazing kip up.
Sho Nuff does another kip up. Yeah, he did one earlier in the film, and I'm like, this dude's an athletic motherfucker. Yeah,
like, he does another kip up, and then he pulls him up again and says, I'm going to ask you one more time who's the master, but Leroy still doesn't answer.
Eddie, this is a weird moment. Eddie leaves Laura. He sort of tethered her to a railing or something, and he wanders off, and he says, I love you.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Fucking what? Like, oh, what? That's a fucking weird shit
Maybe Eddie's like, I'm going to be her manager or something.
She's going
like,
to be the new Angela maybe, or some yeah. type thing. It was a weird thing. She could have also easily freed herself
right.
from her tethers, and she just doesn't.
Right.
But so Sho Nuff has Leroy like beaten to shit. He's dunking his head in this tank of water
right.
or whatever, and he's demanding like Leroy tell him who's the master. Eddie wants Sho Nuff to just like fucking
just
stop.
Drown him.
Just drown the fucker.
For Jesus Christ's sake, just drown him.
Yeah, Sho Nuff's got his own agenda, which is, I guess, to be the best martial artist.
I think in
Harlem.
In a weird way, it's like an honor thing. It's like I need to hear you say it.
It's Mate. Yeah,
I made him say Mate.
Frankie. So, fuck.
Jackson.
Oh my god. Oh, I want to watch Bloodsport now.
Yeah, we're going to put Bloodsport on here in a second.
So, Sho Nuff is dunking Leroy's head in the water. Leroy's having all these flashbacks now of earlier scenes. It's like he's seen his accomplishments and
whatnot.
And
this is, I got big Bloodsport vibes during this. And I was like, did they rip all this off or did it happen
in another
movie?
Did flashbacks? Yeah. Oh, wait, when he was training with Shinoshi Tanaka? Yeah.
Like with the goldfish and like being underwater and training underwater, like okay, all that shit was a flashback.
I feel like it's probably been done 100 times probably before this movie.
But also when he was blinded by Chung Li's powder, he was having the flashbacks of the blind fishing and shit like that.
Absolutely. Like, you gotta have a flashback. You trained for this. So yeah, he sees his sensei saying like there's only one place you have not yet looked, and it is there. Only there that you will find the master. And he sees Laura saying, you sure look like a master to me. She was so fucking horny for him.
Yep.
But Sho Nuff pulls Leroy out of the water. He asks him one last time, all right, Leroy, who is the one and only master? And Leroy says, I am.
What? It's record fucking, scratch.
He's finally fucking clicked for Leroy.
It's me.
An enraged Sho Nuff goes to finish Leroy off with a punch, but Leroy catches his fist out of the air, and then we see the golden glow is like whatever emanating off Leroy's body.
Soul glow.
He goes to start crushing Sho Nuff's hand. Sho starts pleading for mercy. He's like, let me go.
Yeah, because he's like breaking the shit. You're like,
ah, shit.
He's like, God. Damn.
On the subtitles, there was a motherfucker dropped in, but
yeah,
I feel like they cut that out because they could never get a PG-13 if they had a motherfucker
in
the movie.
He is like breaking his hand. It's very funny.
So yes, Leroy mimics that thing that we saw Bruce Lee do earlier, where he's waving his arms, and we get that weird. It's either fast or slow. It fucking looks cool though, and Eddie is watching this. He's like, holy shit. So are we supposed to think that in real life, if you were in that room with him, that's what you would see is what we see on the film?
Yeah, I think we're seeing blurred. Just like we can't tell. It's like I think his arms are moving so fast that it's like, what's happening?
That's fucking badass.
Yeah.
So I love this shit now where Sho Nuff's gearing back up, I guess, to try to fight.
Yeah, he like strikes a pose. He's like, I'm going to give it one more shot.
Cause and his glow is sort of like on the fritz. It's like crackling. And,
yes. And that's awesome.
Yeah, it's fucking great. Leroy, though, absolutely wails on Sho Nuff as the chorus to the Last Dragon song swells.
I love all the blue sparks and golden glow.
Dude,
flying
you were into
with
those
each.
Effects?
Yeah, it's like, well, those looked worse to me than the red ones because it was like, blue sparks and gold glow. I was like, y'all should have just decided on a color and went with it.
Leroy knocks Sho Nuff into that big tank of water with a big kick. He's watching Sho Nuff sort of like float face down and drown in the water. And I guess he considers letting him drown, but then he pulls him out.
I kind of felt like he looked at him and he was like, I'm a nice guy.
He's
I
honorable.
Yeah,
you
exactly.
Don't just let someone die if there's no need. Now, Eddie steps out with the pistol pointed at Leroy. It's fucking about time somebody is like, let's
take
get serious
action.
About this. So Eddie praises Leroy, saying it wasn't the ending I had in mind, but it was a great finish. Says, you see, a 45 will put an end to all this kung fu crap. All it takes is one little bullet. So take your final bow, scum sucker. Eddie shoots, and Leroy is like thrown backwards.
His body whirls as if he's been hit, and just his body, he like falls to the ground.
Right. Laura and Richie are screaming in horror. Eddie approaches to admire, I guess, the dead body.
He starts
body.
Laughing weird, like sinister again, like
over the top.
Over the top. It's like a truck. Like a truck. Like a machine. Like a switch.
Turn her head around. It's like a truck. Do we think Eddie is murdered before?
Definitely.
Okay.
Definitely.
I thought so, too. So Eddie, he rolls Leroy over onto his back. Leroy opens his eyes and smiles and shows he's caught the bullet in his teeth. Fucking, and apparently for not the first time, because they referenced this in Act 1.
Yeah, but wouldn't you think that you were the master if you'd already caught a bullet in your teeth?
No doubt. So Leroy pounces on Eddie, starts punching him out. Richie and Laura are cheering. Leroy hooks his hook into Eddie's like belt or some shit, hoists him up off the ground. Eddie's amazed at Leroy's skills and is like...
his bullet catching trick.
He's trying like, oh my God, I've never seen anything like that. I should be your manager. We could like, give me the...
I'll give you international rights. I'll take domestic. Well, you can have domestic. I'll take international. Or you can have them all. Just give me a finder's fee.
Eddie, like ever the fucking showman or whatever.
We guess.
I guess so. Leroy and Laura give a long, thirsty look to each other. Some more eye fucking going on. Just then, police burst in, as well as the producer and Laura's fucking hair and makeup guy is
there.
Yeah,
bitch, you're late and you have a show to do. Where have you been?
I love the hair and makeup guy is there.
Yeah.
And it's also like the producer is in front of the police officers like coming into this scene.
It's like, we've got to go.
We got a show to do. Laura looks back and Leroy has vanished.
What?
Don't know even why. I guess it's to avoid being caught up in all this, like, being taken into custody or whatever the police would do.
But why would he have been? He didn't kill anyone.
I guess
not.
Or
try to kill anyone. It was self-defense.
Yes. But it's more that a Superman sort of fairy tale.
Right.
You vanished into the ether or whatever shit's
going
on.
But also, he's a black man. He probably would have been incarcerated.
He would have been beaten
or
worse.
Yeah.
Shit. Grim. So, the police take Eddie into custody. He's saying, you know, me, myself, and Mr. Nuff were attacked by a bunch of hoodlums. The cop said some shit about, you're going away for good this time.
Oh, well,
which
good.
Is like, what
Finally.
The fuck is the backstory on these dudes? Like, how many times has Eddie slipped through their fingers?
The arcade magnate of Harlem.
So Laura, again, looks frustrated at having lost Leroy.
Damn it.
Cut to the dance floor is packed.
Yeah, we're back in the Seventh Heaven
Club.
It's
like a white party. Everyone's dressed head to toe white. They're dancing to the glow song.
Richie and Johnny are also there. Like it seems like all the rival dojos are there dancing around.
Right. Is this the dance contest?
I think so. I it must be.
Where did Richie and Johnny get that white wardrobe from?
Well,
maybe they just had it.
Yeah.
Richie has found himself a more like age-appropriate girl to focus on. There is no way any of this would be happening, though. First of all, Laura's like in no condition to be working.
Well, she's up in the control booth, like.
But just, also, the studio is an active crime scene.
Yeah. Oh shit! This happened moments later.
After there was a not huge even, brawl. Like,
not even an hour later. Good
unless,
call.
Unless a lot of time has passed, this is like they'd be sweeping for fibers, I guess, or whatever the hell goes
That's
on.
That's a great point.
But I think this is supposed to be minutes after all this has just happened.
Yeah, you're totally right. It is.
Cuff all those knocked out goons because we got a show to put on. They whisk Laura like out of the warehouse and into hair and makeup because she's like fully dolled up now. But yeah, forlorn looking Laura, she notices there's this figure sort of obscured behind a curtain. He's holding a bouquet.
Right.
Not a buffet. That's the beer talking.
Hey.
It's not very professional of Laura, I thought, to look so like miserable while she's on the clock or whatever.
Well, yeah. She was almost killed just a moment ago, so yeah.
But so the figure steps out and reveals that it's Leroy, much to Laura's delight.
Yeah. He's in a white gi trimmed in gold with a
big-ass
dragon printed on it.
Do you think he rushed back to the dojo to fetch his white gi?
I think it was sort of like in Masters of the Universe. I think his old clothes just transformed into the new clothes.
Why the fuck not?
When he had the power.
But we see he's like trying to say something
like
to Laura.
Like a fucking dumbass. It's like, no one can hear you.
The music is too loud. But as the show cuts to a commercial, we hear Leroy. He's yelling, would you teach me some moves?
Which is code for, I need to know how to fuck.
Show me how to fuck you.
I need to know how to make your pleasure.
What every girl wants to hear.
Yeah, show me
how to fuck.
Show me how to make your pleasure. I mean,
oh,
it's honest.
Everyone has a big laugh at it, including Laura. While Richie's friend says, like, calls Leroy cornball. He's like, hey, check out the
cornball. Check out the cornball.
And Richie is...
pulls a knife and stabs him.
Richie is enlightened. He's like, he ain't no cornball. He's my brother, and he's the master.
Yeah, Richie has a newfound respect.
And then Richie daps it up with Ty, who's also there. We let 10-year-olds...
I think Richie's going to start taking karate or kung fu.
Why not, dude?
Yeah.
I want to take karate class.
Same.
That'd be fucking bad as hell.
That is the draw of this movie, after all.
So Smokey Robinson's song, First Time on a Ferris Wheel, swells. It's like the love theme for the movie. Yeah. To me, this song, though, sounded like a Stevie Wonder song. Like, I felt like this should have been the Stevie Wonder number. Laura runs to Leroy and they hug in slow motion. There's a bunch of intermittent freeze frames.
Yeah, it's like, so the credits have started and they're running and then they'll pause and then they're frozen in a hug and then it picks back up and it's very strange.
They like, I think of this as like the Teen Wolf ending.
Uh-huh.
Teen Wolf had a long slow motion ending in a freeze frame. They got like 10 freeze frames for the price of one in this shit. But that was the thing, right? We have talked about a bunch of movies where the movie just ends on a freeze frame.
But it's like one of those movies where it shows like people are running in slow motion, then it stops, and they're like, so-and-so went on to become a nurse in the Red Cross. And so-and-so went on to become a drug dealer in Las Vegas. And
Leroy and Laura are lifted up into the rafters on that same platform that she had descended on in the first act or whatever.
When she sang that terrible fucking song.
Dude, they just hoisted them up into the rafters. Like, some stagehand was involved. He was like, oh, they stepped on the shit, let me raise them up.
Yeah.
That must be what's supposed to happen now.
Yeah. That's the end of the movie.
Fade to black, credits roll.
Bye.
That's the fucking flick.
Love it.
Yeah, dude. That's the last dragon.
All right, good night.
No, so the director, Michael Schultz,
said
the commentary, he said his vision for this movie was that it should be a living cartoon, which I would say, oh, yeah,
they accomplished that.
Absolutely.
Friend.
He also said it was, like, pushed through the whole, like, production process very quickly, which he didn't admit this, but I feel like it's definitely because the Karate Kid had just come out and been a huge hit, and they're like, oh fuck, do we got any karate movies we could like fucking make happen.
Yeah,
real
quick. we have to ride that wave.
So this shouldn't come as a surprise, but Michael Schultz said that it got sort of hijacked from him in the editing process, where Berry Gordy was insistent that he handpick every single song that was going to play in the movie.
Naturally.
Because he was thinking about what would be good for business for the record label or whatever. And the director was like, I had more like fitting song. Because there was a lot of weird music choices throughout in this thing.
Yeah. That just didn't fit. They just like, didn't the, go
when
with
they
what
play
was
that
happening.
Stevie Wonder song earlier, and it was like in a moment of peril or whatever, and they're like, upset stomach from a broken heart.
It doesn't.
It's like, huh?
Doesn't make any sense.
But the movie though did well. $10 million budget or so, made about $33 million.
Nice.
It did well. I think it was around the 30th highest grossing movie of that year, 85. 85 was a strong fucking year though at the box
Tell
office.
Me.
Back to the Future led the way. Also,
amazing movie.
Stallone was king in 85. He had like the third and fourth highest grossing movies with Rambo First Blood Part 2 and Rocky 4 came Ooh. Out in 85.
Okay.
One was like summer and one was Christmas or whatever.
Big year for Stallone.
Beverly Hills Cop came out at the very end of 84 and it made most of its money in 85. It was like very highly touted or whatever. Cocoon made a lot of money, which I've never ever seen.
You've never seen Cocoon?
No. Should I?
You should. It's a good movie.
Okay.
Who is it?
Amici and Don a bunch Amici, of other old actors.
Don Amici was in it. Hume Cronin, Jessica Tandy.
Wilford Brimley, was he in
Wilford
it?
Wilford Brimley is in
yeah.
it. And he was like the youngest member of the cast at the
he
time.
He was not old enough. He's just looked old forever.
Yeah.
That dude. But yeah,
Man,
Cocoon
was awesome.
Made big money. Witness was out that year and made a lot of money. Somehow The Goonies came out that year.
Art Selwyn was in that movie. Shit, yeah. Brian Dennehy was in that movie.
Didn't he?
Yeah.
Okay.
Steve Guttenberg, he was like the younger person. They're like, we're trying to help our older family. Yeah, but
was
yeah.
it Ron Howard?
Ron Howard.
That's cool. But The Goonies also came out that year, which I know we discussed earlier. So same year.
Yeah.
It had the same feel to me, this movie, as The Goonies.
Yeah, definitely some elements that were similar.
Like
sure.
weird sort of fantastical kid story, whatever. Further down the list, but relevant to us, they came out that year. First, for me personally, Teen Wolf came out that year.
Yeah.
I love Teen Wolf.
Teen Wolf is awesome.
View to a Kill came out that
and
year.
And big year for Michael J. Fox.
Yeah.
Always. The 80s were huge.
There's no... He had to have done Teen Wolf for me. He had to have done that movie before Back to the Future, but it came out after.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it rode the wave of Back to the Future's success
mm-hmm.
to like doing pretty well itself. View to a Kill came out that year.
Awesome.
Was that the last... That was the last Roger Moore Bond movie?
I believe so.
I think so, too. Mad Max Beyond Thunderdome was out that year. And our boy Arnold put out Commando and Red Sonja.
He was just getting started.
That year.
Just getting started.
Yeah, dude. He had not surpassed Stallone yet, but he would soon.
Oh, just on the cusp of doing it.
So, Schultz had said this was like the one and only movie that he's made that he has consistently had people asking him, like, why they never did a sequel, which is probably a good question, because, like, this movie was right for a sequel.
Like, or right for a reboot now.
IMDb...
Fucking get...
IMDb says there's a reboot in the works, but it had no names attached or anything.
Kendrick Lamar and Beyonce and all these other people doing the soundtrack for it.
Yeah.
Like, it'd be awesome. Like, I'm in. And the cast you could get together for it.
Absolutely. I'm into it. So that needs to happen. But I feel like there's always going to be a market for just karate movies, like good martial arts movies. People love that shit.
They do. And we were talking about this. I guess it's just because it's impressive to see people who have supreme control of their bodies.
Yeah.
In that way, so that they are, and from a, obviously, you know, you're taught from the movies and taught from classes from a defensive standpoint. That's, you know, that's the right way to do it. But it just, everything looks so beautiful. It's so cool.
No, yeah, I think the genre sort of comes and goes. It ebbs and flows, right?
Yeah.
And I feel like we're maybe in a downturn right now for martial arts flicks.
All of the ones that I've seen have been the ones that you just accidentally, since Crouching Tiger, the ones that you, unless it's a superhero movie.
Well, we got to go see the everything.
Yeah.
Everywhere.
Everything and Everywhere All at Once.
I feel like, is that supposed to be like a good kung fu movie?
I think there are elements of it, because I think it's supposed to sort of be like Midnight Library, the Matt Haig novel, where it's like a multiverse thing where it's, you're sort of witnessing all the things that you could have been. And one of the things that this woman could have been was a kung fu expert or a movie star and all these other things. And so, yeah, I'm totally
gotta
into
see
it.
That shit.
Yeah. But it's like, you're right. As far as like martial arts movies, like
it had a big resurgence, right? Probably around the Matrix.
Kiss
times.
Of the Dragon. Jet Li's been in a bunch. Like, there have been lots of Chinese movies that are like 2000s. historical martial arts films and things like that.
You know what? I haven't watched any of all the Ip Man movies.
Those are, the first two are fucking
awesome. Are
they
good?
Yeah, they're very
good. I think they're all on Netflix, so I have no excuse.
The first two, I haven't seen the latter two, but the first two are awesome.
Okay. Yeah, I got to check that
out. They are worth a... if you're just into martial arts movies, they're definitely worth a look.
Okay, I need to check that shit out. Now, one final bit of weirdness from this movie. I don't know if this has any bearing on how good or bad the movie ultimately like turned out to be, or how different it might have been otherwise, but this is a crazy fucking story. So the director, Schultz, told this story about how he and the writer were like polishing up the script or whatever, and this was in the early days of computers, he says. And they were working like on the screenplay in a hotel room or whatever. The other writer had fallen asleep and he was working on edits or whatever. And basically the studio, I guess, had told him he needed to cut some budget out of this film.
Mm-hmm.
So they were looking for things to cut. But Schultz says he accidentally like deleted 40 pages from the script.
Oh my God.
And there was no way to recover it, and they had to do the best they could to reconstruct what had been deleted.
How?
I don't have a fucking clue, man. But imagine that you're like, oh my God, that's like half the movie or a third of the movie or something has fucking been deleted.
That's insane.
We have a vague memory of what they had to rewrite all the scenes. Or whatever. I don't know if that helped or hurt the movie in the long run, you know.
They quote unquote accidentally did it, but it was because it was shit that Barry had made them put in, and they're like, "How do we get rid of this?"
It could be. Yeah.
Well, I just thought of another Crouching Tiger, Kung Fu Hustle. That movie fucks hard.
I haven't seen that one,
dude. We need Who's to watch that movie. Just unless you're,
is it not a big name person?
No.
I keep hearing that title. Yeah,
we need it. It is amazing.
Is it like a Hong Kong flick or what is it?
I don't.
When did it come out?
Mid 2000s, early 2000s, mid to early 2000s.
Okay, I'm here for it.
Let me look at a gargle real quick. Kung Fu Hustle. Kung Fu Hustle came out in 2004.
Okay.
So, yeah, Stephen Chow, Y Yuen, Chi Yan, Si Lung Yung, Chao Gang Fang.
Of course.
I mean, but the thing is like, you're not going to recognize any of these names unless you're.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. But the movie is amazing. It's one of the most beautiful.
Is it amazing,
and it's an amazing
just for
story.
The martial art, for the choreography and everything?
Yes,
or
but also
actually...
because it's a cool story, because it's about this dude who's a fuck up. That ends up, it's like, oh shit, he's a kung fu master and he didn't know it. It's sort of like, you know, kind of like this in a way. So there's something in it that relates to this, but
yeah,
objectively a better movie and with better martial arts.
but
this podcast is not about that. It's about The Last Dragon.
And I love this movie.
I do too.
I mean, no apologies.
Oh my God, no. It's like turning it on. I was like, there's nothing about this movie that I would change at all.
No, even like the less polished actors, the Vanities and Timox, like they give the right performance, I feel like, for this movie.
Yeah. And I feel like as far as like racist politics and things like that go, it's like white people weren't allowed. Like
no.
You don't get to do shit in this movie because you're like, this is not for you.
If you're another like disenfranchised group, then I feel like you can sort of picks that low-hanging fruit and everything like that. And it's fucking great.
Yeah,
I'm into it in a big, big way.
And become coming at it from like a place of fun, frivolity.
Yeah.
Like in respect, not from a place
of... There was nothing mean-spirited in the whole movie.
Nothing being overtly racist. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
So, fucking great movie. I'm glad we talked about it. I'm glad you suggested it. It's like
a lot of fun.
Fucking way off the beaten path.
Yeah, big time.
But everyone should see this movie because it's freaking great.
It is good viewing. Just crack open a keg of beer.
He has a drink or 12.
And sit down and enjoy it because it is a lot of fun.
It's a crowd pleaser. We hope you've been pleased.
Yeah. I hope you guys stick around. Hope this hasn't put you off the 6DOS.
No, we'll be back. We'll return to our Schwarzenegger or like hardcore action roots, I'm sure, pretty soon.
Yeah, for some Van Damme or some Stallone.
I don't know what's up next, but we're going to get into it. It's going to be fucking great.
Yeah. In the meantime, we'll be back. There is no-